Bam, Mr. Taru. We are going to take a look at, over the next few videos, at a couple of laws. We're going to lay down the law that allow you to solve for missing sides and angles of non-right triangles or oblique triangles. Now, the first one that we're going to take a look at is Law of Sines, which says, and let's not forget, lowercase letters are for sides and uppercase letters are for angles. So we have side A, or A over the sine of A, equals B over the sine of B, equals C over the sine of C. And all the lowercase letters are sides. Now, you can't have an equation with two equal signs in it at the same time. There's no such thing as a, well, I'm not going to work with three-sided equations. So we're only going to use, you know, two of these at a time. We're going to know, or we need to know, an angle and its opposing side. We need at least that set up as enough information to start the problem. And then we'll set up another fraction based on, you know, whatever missing parts of the triangle we're dealing with. Now, not all oblique triangles can be set up and solved using the law of sines. If you cannot use law of sines to solve a triangle, find its missing angles and sides, and you use the law of cosine, which is in another video. I'll put a post of it over my head here. So, before we get started though, there's another video after this as well that's going to be the ambiguous case for law of sines. See, you're just going to be given information about a triangle, and you're going to need to understand if that information given sets up one triangle, maybe it doesn't even set up a single triangle at all, or there's two answers. And that's the ambiguous case for law of sines. So as we look at these problems today, we need to keep in mind some geometry postulates or theorems that you learned a couple of years ago. The congruency theorems, or the congruency theorems you learned for proving that two triangles were congruent, or the same size and shape. Similarity theorems as well, but we're going to leave out the AA postulate. So, your congruency theorems from geometry, some of them were angle-angle side, side-angle side, angle-side-angle, and side-side-side. And there was like a hypotenuse leg theorem as well if you were dealing with the right triangle, but we are not. Now, we're not going to be proving two triangles are congruent. We're not doing two-column proofs. But we are going to have to look at the information given to us and see if it follows one of those four patterns. And I'm also not saying that all four of these patterns are set up for law of sine either. Some of them will be law of cosine. Like, for this side-side-side setup, the only way to solve for that oblique triangle would be with law of cosines, which is a later video. And a topic is probably in the next section of your textbook. What we want to pay attention to is that we do not have a setup like this. And again, I'm just giving you a preview of the next video, the ambiguous case for law of sines. If information is given to us in the SSA pattern, and we all know what that spells backwards, it's not a good word because we can't use it. That is not a congruency postulate, but some questions will give you information in this setup, and if you have that, then there's a possibility of no triangle being set up. You can't even do one at all. One answer or two answers. So, thus, the ambiguous case for law of sines follows this postulate here, the side-side angle, or not postulate, but pattern. And it's not a congruency theorem, so when you get this, you know that you have a much tougher question. It might not even make a triangle at all. You might have two answers. But that's not for this video, so let's just forget about it for now. Okay, our first example is going to be a triangle looking like this. We got angles of A, B, and C, and I'm not drawing this to scale, so don't need to never trust a drawing to scale unless it says that in a math book. So we have an angle A of 44 degrees and angle C of 61 degrees. And opposite angle C, we have side C, which is going to be 52 units. Now, as I go around this triangle and identify how the information is given to us, if I go in a counterclockwise rotation, and you're not allowed to skip a side and an angle. So we have angle 61, no information given about this side here of side B, so I need to have information about the next angle. So we have angle, angle, side. And it is a congruency theorem from geometry. So this is only going to have you know, with this information given, there's only one possible triangle, and while this is not drawn to scale, this is the triangle. Now, I can't go around in another direction. Like, I can't say it's side and then skip an angle and skip a whole side. I can't skip two parts of that triangle. This is not side and then angle, angle. I could do this way, but as you try and look at the information given, go, you know, either counterclockwise or clockwise, but you can skip a side, you can skip an angle that does not have information, but not two. So we can't rotate around this way and say that it's side, angle, angle, because you're skipping two blank pieces of information. Okay, let's solve this triangle. Enough talking. So, we have got, let's find side A. So we have A, lowercase a, over the sine of 44 equals 52 over sine of 61. And here we go. If you're going to set up the law of sine in an oblique triangle, you need to have a side and its corresponding angle paired up. You need both of those to be able to work out the law of sine. If you don't have this opposite pairing, then the oblique triangle is going to need to be set up and you're going to solve it by using the law of cosine. However, we do. So we have A divided by sine of 44 equals 52 over the sine of 61. And anytime we're trying to solve an equation and we want to move something away from the variable, we always just have to do the opposite math operations. That's A divided by sine of 44. So we're going to multiply those sides by the sine of 44. And so we have A equals 52 times the sine of 44 over the sine, the sine of 61. Okay, so we have 52 times the sine of 44 divided by the sine of 61. If you're using a T83 or a T84 with older software and you can't put it in that calculator in this math type format, then you want to wrap the 52 in parentheses. When you type in sine, it's going to open up another parentheses for you automatically. Close those two before you type in the division of the sine of 61. If you get that into your calculator correctly, you're going to get A is equal to 41.3 units. Okay, now, if you're in a science class, your science teacher might be really enforcing, or even your math teacher really enforcing the idea of significant digits. And they might not really like you putting a calculated value that appears to be more accurate than the measured values. So like really, if this is rounded off the nearest whole number and there's no .0, this kind of technically needs to be rounded off to 41. I don't really do that ever, so it's 41.3. Now we want to find side B. Well, to find side B, you know, I've got a side and angle pairing, but I don't know this side, and I don't know this angle. I can't do law of sine if I have both of those pieces missing, the angle and corresponding side. But there's 180 degrees inside of a triangle, so this shouldn't be too hard to figure out. We have 180, now we have minus 40 is 140. 140 minus 60 is 80. Now it's 79 and 75 degrees. Okay, so we have enough information now to find side B. Okay, so we have enough information now to find side B. And I'm going to do B over the sine of 75 degrees equals, and I'm going to use this 52 and 61 degrees pairing again, because if I hit a button wrong and the 41.3 is a little bit off because I made a careless mistake, I don't want to carry that mistake into another answer of the question. So it's going to be B over the sine of 75 degrees equals 52 over the sine of 61 degrees. And B is equal to 52 times the sine of 75 degrees divided by the sine of 61. And that comes out to be 57.4 units. Okay, one more example. Actually, two more. We're going to do one more example with law of sine, and then I want to explain to you about finding the areas of an oblique triangle using the sine function. So we have this information. The measure of angle A is 10 degrees. The measure of angle C is 43 degrees. And side B is equal to 21 units. Well, I don't have a drawing, but I'm just going to, you know, we're talking about triangles. We're talking about shapes. It's kind of like we're doing geometry. We are doing geometry. So anytime we're doing geometry, I like to give myself a drawing. And clearly, I did not look at the numbers. I just made a generic triangle. I'm not drawing it to scale. I just want a place so I can put the numbers, so I can see what's going on. I don't care about the measurements appearing to be correct. A is 10 degrees. Clearly, that's almost 45 degrees the way I've drawn it. C, angle C is 43 degrees. And side B is 21 units. Now, if I go around this triangle, my information is given to me in the angle-side-angle pattern. So, angle-side-angle is a congruency theorem you learn in geometry, and thus there is only one solution, one triangle that you can set up with this given information. And I'm going to just help you set up one side and not really finish this one because it works exactly the same as the other example. We're going to find side A. So, A over the sine of 10 degrees equals, now I've got the 21, but again, you can't set up the law of sine unless you have a pairing of side and angle. So while I have the 21, and that's the only side of the triangle I know, if I'm going to use law of sine, I have to know the measure of the angle opposite to 21, but again, inside of a triangle that must add up, the interior angles must add up to 180 degrees. So 180, 140, 130 minus 3 is 127 degrees. Okay, so now I do have that opposite side and angle pairing, and we get the sine of 127. We multiply both sides by the sine of 10 to undo that division, and we have A is equal to 21 times the sine of 10 degrees over the sine of 127. Bam! Okay. Now, just type that in your calculator, right? You'll have the answer. Or it's 4.6. Okay. 4.6. Okay. For our last example, we're going to help you find the area of an oblique triangle. Now you're going to learn two new formulas for the area of a triangle, and I have a video posted up already that ties both of those together in the same example. But since, you know, I'm going to go over this formula here with you in a second, and it's in the same, probably in the same section of your textbook where you've learned the law of sine. So let's tie in what some knowledge that we already know with these new formulas that we see for area of a triangle, which, you know, are honestly just really convenient for certain cases. And we have this triangle. So we have an oblique triangle, it's not a right triangle, and we're going to find the area. Well, area of a triangle is equal to 1/2 base times height. Well, if you're going to find the area of a triangle using this old formula known for years now, 1/2 base times height, you need the length of the base and you need the height. Let's pick a different color. Okay, so we've got the area of a triangle, which is 1/2, the base is 9, and we're going to find the height. Now, the height is not 7. The height is not this unknown value over here, and clearly it's at a slant. How are we going to find the height of that triangle, that oblique triangle? And I've already kind of given you a hint here because I've dropped the altitude down to make a perpendicular connection or a 90 degree angle. So what we're going to do is to find the height is we're going to highlight this triangle here. We're going to remember that the 9 is now at least temporarily not a number that we're interested in because it's the entire length of the triangle, which is not a right triangle. But for the green triangle I've temporarily drawn over our diagram, we have a right triangle. So we can go back to SOHCAHTOA! Sine's opposite over hypotenuse, cosine is adjacent over hypotenuse, and tangent is opposite over adjacent. And from the 21, what do we have and what do we want? We want the opposite side, which is not really a side of our triangle, but it's the height. And we want the hypotenuse, again, of the green triangle. So the sine of 21 degrees is equal to the opposite side of h over the hypotenuse of 7, and h comes out to be 7 times the sine of 21 degrees. So let's just write that out. 7 times the sine of 21 degrees. And this comes out to be 11.3 square units. And you might have done this work in geometry. And if you haven't, well, there you go. But there's another formula that is in your law of sine section that looks like a new formula, but indeed it really is not. It says this: the area of a triangle, it's like another version of area. The area of a triangle is 1 half AB sine of C. And then it also says, well, it's also equal to 1 half AC sine of B. And, by the way, it's also equal to 1 half, let's see, I've used AB, AC, so BC sine of A. Hello, they're all the same formula. It would be really helpful sometimes if we would kind of get off our everything has to be a variable kick and just write some of this stuff in words. I mean, what do we really have here? Well, first of all, before I validate to you that this old stuff that we did to find area is exactly what this says already, but before I validate that, or point it out to you if you don't see it yet, all three of these versions, all they say is the area of a triangle is equal to 1 half, okay? These are lowercase letters, so they're two sides. So how about side sub 1 times side sub 2, yeah, just indicate there's two sides. And this is AB and it's angle C. This is AC and angle B. This is BC and angle A. Well, this example is going to, you know, I can use these formulas for this example, otherwise why would I be talking about it? The two sides are coming together to make the angle of 21 degrees. What do you call that when you have two sides coming together to make an angle? That's an included angle, some vocab word you probably haven't talked or said or heard since geometry, but this is two sides of a oblique triangle. Remember, we're finding the area of this large oblique triangle, not the green temporary triangle I made to find the height. Two sides and included angle. So if you have two sides and an included angle of an oblique triangle, then you can find the area just by doing 1 half times the two sides times the sine of the included angle. And clearly, you're not going to see this in a textbook. Your textbook is going to write three different versions, but they're all the same thing. Now, look what we got here. 1 half, 9, the base, if you will, times 7, that's the other side that we have, times the sine of 21 degrees. These are two sides, and this is our included angle. So by using some skills we knew from really geometry, much less the trig that we just learned, we can see the tie-in with what we did, you know, years ago in geometry with these new formulas that our pre-calc book has given us, you know, and just seeing that it's really not new. It just looks different and thus, you know, might give you something new to memorize, but it is not new. You've already been doing these formulas, only you did them in two pieces. 1 half base times height, and your old SOHCAHTOA stuff for finding the missing sides of a right triangle. I'm Mr. True. Bam! Go do your homework. Thank you very much for watching.